Be here. Thanks for coming today. I had a chance to meet with the mid-season freshmen today, and saw the excitement in their eyes, saw the enthusiasm that that we all share about being part of Vols football. But this is a great opportunity for me. I've known Butch Jones since 1990. He's a good person. He's a good friend. Done a lot of good things here, and at the end of the season, at the end of the NFL season, we talked about the chance of working together. I'm really excited about it. I think this is a tremendous opportunity. I think with Butch's leadership and the work that he's done here to develop this program, playing at Neyland Stadium, being here in Knoxville, the resources that the University of Tennessee provide, I wanted to be part of it. And I told Butch there's two reasons I'm here. I want to help him achieve his goals, the University of Tennessee football's goals, and help these kids win a championship. So I'm excited and I'm open to your questions.
You said you've known Butch for about 20 years. Just how does that relationship go back? How did y'all kind of connect, and how often had y'all kept in touch over the years?
Okay. I was the head strength coach for the University of Rutgers in New Jersey. Butch was a graduate assistant on the offensive side. Butch liked training, coming down to train and work out. And he wanted to bench press a lot of weight, and so we started training together. We became close friends. I was part of him and Barb's wedding. I stood up for him at his wedding. And through the years, we've watched Butch grow, Central Michigan, Cincinnati, and now here at the University of Tennessee. My wife and I would watch all the games. And she yells, "Let's go, Butcher!" And I'm like, "Terry, he can't hear you." And she goes, "Oh, yes, he can." Terry worked in the football office at the University of Rutgers, and so she got to know Butch in a different way, too, working in the office. But, Butch and Barb have been great to us, and just really excited to be together again.
Yeah, how long will it take you to kind of assess the team and their needs in terms of what you're going to bring to the strength program here?
Well, I have a good plan. I'm excited for what we're going to do. And, like I told the freshmen this morning, I'm just one man. Now, I've got the plan. I can provide the leadership. But they've got to help. They've got to be working with me on this. And together, I think we can accomplish a lot. As far as assessing the team, it's an ongoing process. I don't know many of the guys, and I'll start meeting more of the guys tonight. We're going to have position group meetings starting tomorrow, and just have kind of a skull session with each group to determine where their goals lie and what their thought process is. So it's an ongoing process. I would say, as far as fully assessing the team, it may take the full off season to be able to really sit down and say, what are this team's strengths and weaknesses.
Patrick, and then Rob
and Wes. Rob, I don't know how many years exactly it's been, but you've spent the last number of years in the NFL. Do you think there will be an adjustment in going to working day to day with college players and college kids now?
Yeah, I had 22 years of college experience before I went to the NFL, 17 in the NFL, so it's 39 years. And one of the questions that's often asked of me is, do you have children? No, I don't have children. My wife and I don't have children. But these are my guys. And I've always had the belief that you raise these young men the way you want them to be. And I want them to be aggressive, confident, and detailed. It's about getting to know the players, knowing what buttons to push, raising them like they're your own. And I look forward to developing those special relationships with this team.
And, you know, kind of piling on that, just what is the big, having done both, what's the biggest difference in working with, you know, grown men in the NFL as opposed to, like you just mentioned, you met the freshman 18-year-old kids today?
Yeah, you know, I think with the older player, the 22-year-old and older, they maybe have a little bit more developed reasoning skills that, you know, if there's an issue, you can sit down and talk and come up with a plan. I also learned in the NFL that as a coach, it's not me talking to the players. It's more like, you know, together we've got to make this thing happen. It's not so much like, here's the plan, I expect you to do it. It's, hey, let's come up with a plan that we kind of mutually agree upon, and then let's go like hell and make it happen. The 18-year-old maybe doesn't have that experience, and there may have to be a little bit more direction and leadership, but I'm looking for the older kids to help me lead the team, and that's a process that we're about to start.
Wes, Austin, and Danny? Mike, I know that Tennessee sort of prides itself on a lot of its facilities, a lot of the things that it's, the bells and whistles and those things around here. Did you see what you needed to see from that standpoint in terms of the facilities here and the strength stuff?
Yeah, you know, when I first saw the weight room, I thought to myself, I haven't been in a gym like this for a while. This is nice. We've got good equipment. We rearranged a few things, kind of moved the furniture around a little bit to make it work more with my style. But our facilities are nice. And, you know, over time we may change a few things here and there. But for right now, it was just manpower and moving some things and taking a few pieces out. I haven't had a facility this nice for a while.
Rock, you said that your former players are your guys. I know one of those is Jim Garantano. Is it kind of bring you back full circle to know that, you know, all of a sudden you're, and I'm sure you've probably done it before, but, you know, we're going to be helping a kid that, you know, you helped his dad?
Yeah. It's right. I'm getting old. I've been around for a while. But, you know, Jimmy was great, you know, very personable, lots of energy, enthusiasm, good player, great to be around. And I'm hoping Jarrett's a lot the same. I've met Jarrett, and I've watched him train a little bit. I like what I see, but I certainly don't feel that old. You know, to think that I'm coaching guys' sons. You know, the players that I had previously working with their sons. But it'll be fun. It'll be a good part of it.
I know you've been around the NFL a long time, like you said. Do you know any guys from your time in the NFL that played at Tennessee that you had heard things about being here, Nairn Hayden, Reggie White, any of those type of guys?
You know, I worked with Chad Clifton, Scott Wells, Leonard Little, three of my favorite guys. When I first got to the St. Louis Rams, Leonard was there and was I can't remember if I was with him 1 or 2 years, but it was near the end of his career. Wow, what a great guy. As far as leadership, as far as work ethic, as far as positive energy. Always been impressed with the guys that came from the University of Tennessee. Scotty Wells worked hard, Chad worked hard. You know, and that's part of the process too. You think about, you know, what were the guys like that you worked with that came from this program, and it's all been good. Scott Wells reached out to me today. Via text and said, hey, is there anything I can do to help? Just let me know. So that's been great.
Coach over here. Mm-hmm. What are the differences between, you know, working with the pro athlete and the college athlete? Will you treat these college athletes much like you treated the pro athletes, or is there some adjustment, I guess, in how you'll train them?
Yeah, you know, there will be some adjustment, but you look at athletes today and they're pretty educated, way more than when I first started in the business. And of course, with their iPhones and so forth, if you say anything that's not quite truthful, they're going to look it up and say, you know, I don't know if that's factual, coach. It says here that that's not true. So They're smarter than they've ever been. They're more educated. Their high school programs are better. And I'll know here shortly how and when I need to change some of my philosophies, my approach to things. It's been a while for me, so it'll be a little time to adjust.
I kind of piggybacking on that. What is your philosophy? What sort of background do you have and come from? Is it, you know, more the Olympic style that they have been previously doing? And you also kind of alluded to a plan. If you could kind of give us, you know, even maybe some outlines of what that is over the next maybe into spring practice.
Yeah, you know, I'm a free weight guy. I believe in planning progressions. I believe in using periodization charts and kind of doing the mathematics to help the kids choose weights. But my philosophy is that I want the program to be balanced. I want the program to be challenging. I want the kids that every time they leave, they're saying, that was successful. I can't wait to go back again for the next workout. It's tightly scheduled. It's very concise. I want to engage the kids as much as possible in what we're doing. You know, in the years past, it was easy to say to a kid, hey, we've got four sets of five reps on this exercise. Well, kids today, with their attention spans, they're like, another four sets of five workout. But if you take those 20 reps and you say, okay, instead we're going to go 6-5, 4-3, and you're changing the reps, you're changing the amount of weights that they're handling, they're adjusting to a new demand with each set, now they're more engaged. And I say to them, okay, on your last two sets in that 6-5-4-3, I want to see the four so that you and I can determine what we're going to do for the three rep set. Totally engaged in the workout. I'm really good at math. I really understand the percentages. And so when I say, I think you can do this weight, and you know, three might be difficult, but I think you have a chance to do four. You want to try four? What's the kid going to do? He's probably going to go for four. And progress is made. And trust is built. And the understanding that we're working together is happening. Without that coach's involvement, it gets kind of boring. And I want it to be exciting. I want it to be challenging. I want there to be variation. I'm going to use chains and bands and all types of different apparatus to keep their bodies adjusting to new stimulus. Want them coming in not knowing exactly what's going to be expected of them other than the fact that they're going to work hard enough to make a change in their body and have trust that we're going to take them from point A and get them to point B.
Rock, I'm Patrick Murray from WBIR Channel 10. I just wondered how you got the nickname Rock and who gave it to you.
Okay, my dad gave it to me. Born in 1955, the heavyweight boxing champion of the world was Rocky Marciano. My folks had picked out a name, and when dad first saw me, he said, that looks more like Rocky. And mom wasn't too sure about the name Rocky. So days later, they put on my birth certificate the name Roger. Dad called me Rocky forever. And when my dad died, my mom started calling me Rocky. She had always used the name Roger up till then. I have two brothers. One always called me Rocky. The other one called me Roger. I don't know if the name fits or if I grew into the name. But it's been with me since birth.
What will you miss about life in the NFL? And I watched all the Hard Knocks in August. What were those moments like when you're leading a guy to Coach Fisher or whomever, knowing their career is about to end potentially? How did that weigh on you? Are you glad to be done with that? Or what will you miss from the NFL?
I'm glad to be done with it. You know, it was. I think the philosophy was that who knows the kids better than the strength coach? We spend more time with the guys than anybody else, and we know the whole team. So who better to go up to a young man and say, you know, we need to go see Coach. And the emotions ran the gamut. Some of the guys knew, you know, and it's been great, appreciate it, it's been fun, you know, and hope to see you again and that type of thing. Whereas the other kids broke down on their way to see Coach that, you know, this was the end of the road, and you tried to explain to them that the NFL is a very small fraternity, and perhaps with the good work that they've done with the Rams, perhaps they had a chance with another team, and not to give up on that dream. I won't miss that part. You know, the cut down day. Oftentimes, I pulled them right from the weight room, right from their workout, where they kind of learned to trust you as their coach and their mentor, the supervisor in the weight room, if you will. To all of a sudden, you know, here I come and I'm the Turk, and they know it's the end of the line. And it's funny. Steven Jackson was, you know, a fine running back for the Rams for many, many years, and Chase Reynolds is a special teams player. That in his first year, Chase came to me and he says, "If my name's on the list, I'll be in the running backs room." And Chase's name wasn't on my initial list, but I got a second list with just his name. Need to see Chase. And so I go to the running backs room, and there's Chase sitting with Steven Jackson. And I open the door, and I'm looking right at Chase, and he goes, "Steven, I think he's calling you." And I said, "No, Chase, this one's for you, and we've got to go see Coach." That was trying. And, you know, most of the guys would come back down to the weight room and say, you know, it was great, great to get to know you, great working with you. And, you know, no hard feelings type of thing. But that was difficult. That was difficult, and I'm glad that part of my career is over.
Are we doing snapping here?
I hope so.
Brett talked about that a lot.
Yeah, you know, snapping to Brett Favre was always interesting. He's a very positive and encouraging type of person that, you know, snapping to the quarterbacks is during the individual period, during one-on-one, during seven-on-seven. I would snap between 100 and 150 snaps per practice. And after every practice, Brett said, "Thanks." And not everybody does that, but he did. And he became a special friend. I've snapped for 14 years. And if you add it up, it's about 140,000 snaps. And I think I had two that weren't very good. That was funny. Okay. But it's fun. You know, you're engaged in practice. You're part of practice. And it makes practice go a lot faster rather than just standing back and watching. And you get to know the quarterbacks. And I've snapped to about 30 different quarterbacks over the course of 14 years.
Coach, we always hear about how the strength coach works hand in hand with the head coach, the relationships that are built, take on a bit of the coach's philosophy. What will you bring from Jeff Fisher in your time with him? He's obviously a very well-respected NFL head coach. What could you bring from him here, do you think?
I think the things I hope I bring, number one is the patience and the understanding that sometimes things don't go exactly the way you had planned. And Coach Fisher was great at, you know, listening and being a problem solver. So, you know, if something had happened that wasn't necessarily all that good and you talked to Coach Fisher, it was rather than being upset, he said, "Well, let's find a way to make this better. Let's find a solution to this problem." So if I could bring problem solving and patience from what I learned from Coach Fisher, that would be a blessing.
Coach, you talked about the guys from Tennessee that you met in the league. Do you have any dealings with, you know, maybe Coach Stuckey years ago or Johnny Long or anybody that, you know, has been a part of the weight program here in Tennessee?
You know, I know of John Stuckey and Johnny Long. I don't know them, you know, personally. I know John is gone, but highly respected. Bruno Paletto was the strength coach before Coach Stuckey, And I went to a clinic in 80, no, probably be more like 92. Does that sound about right? 91, 92. And Bruno was talking. And I was at Rutgers at the time. I think my timing's right. It might be off. But anyways, Bruno's talking about his philosophy, and he's talking to the young strength coaches, and I was in that group, and he was saying, be yourself in the weight room, because the kids will see through you if you're not. And when you're teaching an exercise, teach the things that you teach best. Feel comfortable teaching those things that you're most excited. And if there's something that you have difficulty teaching, find somebody else to do it or move on to the next exercise. So, you know, listening to Bruno, I'm like, that's cool. Just be yourself. Do the things that you believe in. Don't do things just because somebody else is doing it. You know, play to your strengths. You know, study what you do best and go from there. But I know many of the strength coaches, friends of mine, both in college and in the NFL, were touched by John Stuckey and spoke so positively of him. And really, it's an honor to be here following in those guys' footsteps.
Thank you, Coach.
Thank you. All right. Thanks so much.